welcomed worship on Good Friday. I'm Linda Hopwood, pastor of Ives Chapel United Methodist Church. Good Friday has always struck me as an odd name for such a day as this. No one's completely certain about how the day came to be called Good Friday. Some Bible scholars think the name originally may have been God's Friday, and that morphed into Good Friday. The events of this day are painful and, on the surface, don't seem to be good. But God has taken those painful events and turned them into something exceptionally good. This service premiered at 3 p.m. on Good Friday because, according to the Gospels, Jesus hung on the cross from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. He spent 6 hours in unspeakable agony before he died at 3 p.m. For the past 6 weeks, we've gathered at the foot of the cross as we've pondered the 7 final statements Jesus makes before his death. Today we're going to consider what it cost him to share those words that still speak to us today. The 4 Gospels tell us a difficult story. Before he was nailed to a cross, Jesus was tortured. He was publicly flogged. Roman soldiers used whips of leather thongs interwoven with sharp, jagged pieces of bone and lead. Each lash slashed his back, and as the flogging continued, cut into his muscles. After flogging Jesus, the soldiers jammed a crown of thorns on his head, spit on him, and beat him with a rod. All this before nails were driven through his wrists and feet. To fight off suffocation, he would have to pull himself up by his wounded arms and feet. When air is so precious and each breath so painfully won, Jesus still uses his precious breath to share his final thoughts with people who are near and with us. The pain he experienced would be indescribable. It was excruciating, a word that literally means out of the cross. Jesus suffered this way for 6 hours on Good Friday for us. There are many ways to explain how his suffering and death save us. I think it's enough to understand that God's purpose in the cross is to bring us into right relationship with God and neighbor, and to join us in a community of faith that shares God's love with others. On this day, more than any other day, we can only prayerfully reflect on the cost of what Jesus has done for us. Sometimes there are no words to describe what Jesus did for us and what it means. Sometimes music, instead of words, helps us to be moved by the crucified Jesus. O sacred head now wounded, is it him that takes place on Good Friday? It can offer us a time of reflection on Jesus' pain and suffering, his willingness to die so that we might have everlasting life. I invite you to listen to this first verse. For me, the melody alone draws me toward a sense of something riveting, sorrowful, and profound. Johann Sebastian Bach was so taken with this melody that he harmonized this hymn and used it in many of his works. The setting used in the United Methodist Hymnal was adapted from one of Bach's settings of this tune, found in his monumental work, Passion According to St. Matthew. The melody and harmonies invite us to stop and listen, to feel for ourselves a passionate grief, but to also experience the sense of profound hope and wonder as we think of the beauty and elegance that life, the head of our Savior. We might find ourselves wanting to focus on the gruesome image of the nails that pierce his hands and feet. But when we look back at his head, his face, we're drawn to his eyes. Even amidst his pain, his eyes radiate an unforgettable love. Jesus is our head. He is the head of the church, the head of the body of Christ. His sacred head is wounded, with grief and shame weighed down. The shame that weighs him down is ours. He bears the shame of humanity for our cruelty, our inhumanity, our faithlessness, our violence. His head is scornfully surrounded with thorns, thine only crown. In our region, there are hawthorn trees that have thorns of 1 to 3 inches long. The thorns are sharp enough they can cause puncture wounds and prompt serious symptoms such as redness and swelling. In Palestine, there is a thorny branch that grows in fields and along roadsides that has long, sharp thorns. The spines on the vine cause itching, inflammation, and intense pain. Imagine what it must have been like for Jesus to have sharp thorns pressed into his head.
What though my Lord has suffered was all for sinners' gain. Mine was the transgression, but thine the deadly pain. Lo, here I fall, my Savior, 'tis I deserve.
this hymn can draw us into a sense of reverent wonder, or stricken shame as we reflect on Jesus' sacrifices for us. What thou, my Lord, hast suffered was all for sinners' gain. Mine was the transgression, but thine the deadly pain. The word mine is repeated, perhaps to make the verse work with the music, or perhaps the repetition is a way to remind me that it is my sin, to remind us that it is our sin that put Jesus on the cross. Look on me with thy favor, the verse says. Does Jesus look on us with favor? In the midst of his torturous pain, Jesus looks upon those who put him on the cross and asks God to forgive them. When a dying criminal puts his trust in Jesus, he assures the criminal he'll join Jesus in paradise. Jesus looks at his mother and John, the beloved disciple, and sees a new kind of family, a family that gives us a view of what it is to be in loving community with each other. Jesus looks at us with mercy and love. In the third verse, we hear, what language shall I borrow to thank thee, dearest friend? When we face trials, there simply are no words. We just need to have someone standing beside us as we face the death of a loved one, the loss of a job, the news of a devastating illness. Jesus is such a friend. Indeed, our very dearest friend. In Michelangelo's Pietà, Mary tenderly cradles Jesus' head. May we too hold him in our hearts and minds, tenderly, gently, with all the love we have to give. May we prayerfully ask him, oh, make me thine forever. Lord, let me never, never outlive my love to thee.
What anguish shall I borrow to thank thee, dearest friend, for this thy dying sorrow, thy pity without end? Oh, make me thine forever, and should I fainting be, Lord, let me ever, ever outlive my love to thee.
Writing hundreds of years before the time of Jesus, the prophet Isaiah speaks of a servant of God who suffers for us. Isaiah 53 is deep and dark and mysterious writing, but it can't help but remind us of Jesus. Hear how Eugene Peterson renders it in The Message. Who would have thought God's saving power would look like this? The servant grew up before God, a scrawny seedling, a scrubby plant in a parched field. There was nothing attractive about him, nothing to cause us to take a second look. He was looked down on and passed over, a man who suffered, who knew pain firsthand. One look at him and people turned away. We looked down on him, thought he was scum. But the fact is, it was our pains he carried, our disfigurements all the things wrong with us. We thought he brought it on himself, that God was punishing him for his own failures. But it was our sins that did that to him, that ripped and tore and crushed him. Our sins. He took the punishment, and that made us whole. Through his bruises, we are healed. We're all like sheep who've wandered off and gotten lost. We've all done our own thing, gone our own way. And God has piled all our sins, everything we've done wrong, on him. He was beaten. He was tortured, but he didn't say a word. Like a lamb taken to be slaughtered, and like a sheep being sheared, he took it all in silence. Justice miscarried, and he was let off. And did anyone really know what was happening? He died without a thought for his own welfare, beaten bloody for the sins of my people. They buried him with the wicked, threw him in a grave with a rich man, even though he'd never hurt a soul or said one word that wasn't true. Still, it's what God had in mind all along, to crush him with pain. The plan was that he gave himself as an offering for sin, that he'd see life come from it. Life, life, and more life. And God's plan will deeply prosper through him. Out of that terrible travail of soul, he'll see that it's worth it and be glad he did it. Through what he experienced, my righteous one, my servant, will make many righteous ones as he himself carries the burden of their sins. Therefore, I'll reward him extravagantly, the best of everything, the highest honors, because he looked death in the face and didn't flinch, because he embraced the company of the lowest. He took on his own shoulders the sin of many. He took up the cause of all the lost sheep. Emmanuel, God with us, took up the cause of all the lost sheep, including us. The prophet Isaiah also tells us that by his wounds we are healed. Jesus was wounded and died for us. And by his wounds, we are healed. Thanks be to God. Amen.